Hello and welcome to LCDC TV. Today I'm really excited to be interviewing one of the cab trade's big characters, Tony Walker, star of the 7-Up well-acclaimed series. I think it's going to be really interesting. Hello and welcome to LCDC TV. Today, it's my pleasure to be interviewing fellow cabbie, actor, what more can I say? Tony, how are you?
Pleasure to be here, Grant, and once I got the call, I couldn't wait to get here in the hot seat.
Fantastic.
Fantastic.
Listen, as people watching this who are not involved in the cab trade might look at Tony's face and turn off. No, might look at Tony's face and say, where have I seen that before? And to the British public, Tony is well known and well loved as Tony in the world famous series 7-Up. Tony, can you just tell everyone here, how did you get involved in all that? Because you're from Bethnal Green originally.
Yeah, Bethnal Green, and I remember the cameras coming to my school in 1963. And they were looking for diversity from childhood kids that who are advantages and disadvantages of the social scale. So they come to the East End and it was full of snotty-nosed kids with arse hanging out their trousers. I was no less or no, you know, everyone was the same.
Where was your school, Tom?
Bethnal Green in Moulin Street, off of Bishop's Way. And when they came, the school teacher asked which ones are the two ruffians and the girls. I was picked out and took forward. We got taken to Saturday morning pictures. In them days, it was a tanner, sixpence to get in. They filmed us outside waiting to get in there with my girlfriend, Michelle. I love you, she loves me type of thing. Kiss chase, we had all them type of things going on. And the best thing was when they took us to the playground, an adventure playground up in near Shepherd's Bush, like an adventure. I've never been out of Bethnal Green, even as a kid. And they took us there, and all the kids met one another, the posh kids, the middle class kids and all, and it was all, you know, a mix there after that. And
when you first met them, yeah. Bearing in mind that we've all seen the programme, you're, if you're looking at a social scale, money, you were sort of there, and it went up to there. Did the kids at that time have like a class thing, or was you just all kids together?
We were all kids together, that's first and foremost, but the accent was very more distinctive. I was the snotty-nosed kid, you know, one of them type of things. And they were, hey, don't do that. And excuse me, one of them, you know. And it was foreign to me at that age, you know, because all I had was adventure. You know, my dad was in and out of Nick. My mum was in and out of the pub. And I was left to my own devices. And being a street urchin, like the Artful Dodger in them days, which I was, it was a fantastic adventure that I had growing up. It was, and I wouldn't change it for the world.
And what did your family think of you being catapulted into 7-Up? Did they like it?
They were very proud of me, my mum and dad, because you must understand it was a new era. It was the first thing, you know, black and white telly. It only had three channels. And in them days, it was World in Action, groundbreaking documentary films, you know. And with that, to be jettisoned from the boy from the buildings, and in the next breath, I'm on the telly where everyone could see me. It was a game changer, but it was, you know, I was relished in it because, you know, my mum said, oh, I'm so proud of you, Tony, you're on the telly. I didn't realise what was going on. And once you see it back years later, you then can see what they were doing. They were putting the people who got no money or, you know, very, what I would say, less opportunity to the people with a silver spoon in their mouth who got all the opportunity. And they were just showing you what England had become sort of 20 years after the war, you know, and that was the situation.
And what year was that, Tony?
It was filmed in 63, just after John F. Kennedy got assassinated. So that's the benchmark that I remember. And it was aired in May 64, which Michael Apted's input there. He's always followed him on from 1970 and onwards, so it's every 7 years from 1963 up to 1970 and onwards, and that's where we are today.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of quite unusual to have your life in detail every 7 years, documentary like it was, documented, sorry. How do you feel about your life being documented in the world?
I've been asked that many times. I feel so privileged, I feel so lucky that I've been having this documentation of my life throughout my whole life, which it is. My grandchildren now have got the legacy of me being here, and when I'm gone, they can just put me in the video and press the button. Even for my great-great-grandchildren.
That's amazing, isn't it?
And it's going to go on for future generations long after I'm gone. And that's why I'm so blessed, blessed to have it. And as I say, I still reflect on my mum and dad all the time. I love them. Getting a bit emotional now, but they were everything to me. Despite, you know, they give me the last bits of money, whatever they had, anything. And as I say, proper East End family, my family, like, you know, two brothers, one sister. Two brothers are both London cabbies. My sister's a London cabbie. I'm a London cabbie. My son, my wife, all my family, four uncles, three nephews. I must say there's about 22 family members who are cabbies.
Wow. And when did you get your badge, Tom?
I done the knowledge in 76. And I got my badge in 79. It took me 2.5 years to do the knowledge. And it was a fantastic situation. I mean, I did know London, a bit of the West End, but not to great lengths. But having the advantage of my two brothers, who were both cabbies at that particular time. My brother John got out World Cup year 66. My brother Joey got out Jubilee year 77. And when I used to do callovers, they used to tell me how to do it, what I had to do. Be disciplined, yes or no, sir, wear a tie, sit down, you know, move the chair, can I sit down? Always, you know, respectable to the examiners. And, you know, I had my characters, you know, the edges cut off with my brothers telling me how it worked. And I went through it, done well.
And how did you find it when you got out? Did you enjoy it as much as you thought?
I was Tony. I loved it dearly, and most of all, I loved the adventure. It was an adventure for 10 years rather than a job. You know, I mean, to pick up film stars or to go to that club, you see Tramp, or you might see a casino, or you might see the Queen, you might see Prince Charles, and all of a sudden you're there at that particular time. And you think, Christ, I wouldn't have gotten this in and out of a job. Meeting very important people, you know. I mean, I was an ex-jockey many years ago, and I picked Lester Piggott up. And he was my hero. As a kid, all I did then, I eat, drank, and slept horses. Wow. And I sound silly, but it's like someone meeting, say, example, Pele or Maradona, a 16-year-old apprentice footballer, and there you are playing with him. But in this particular case, when I rode at Kempton, Lester Piggott was in the same race. And there I was, that starry-eyed. And all of a sudden, 30 years, 40 years ago later, you know, I met him in the betting shop up in Curzon Street, where I frequently go, and he was there. And I got talking to him, and he said, can you wake me up? I said, of course, Lester, I'll do anything for you, mate. And I picked him up. He was waiting at the window for me, and he's like, looking out.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, he saw me, he put his thumb up, come in. He said, I'm meeting my wife. He said, I said, I'm jumping, Lester, come on, where are you going, mate? Baker Street. Took him to Blandford Street. There's a couple of shops there, sells curtains. He's meeting his wife there. And I asked him all the questions. Who was your best horse? You know,
what was his best horse?
You know, Survivor. I knew everyone. He's about 9 Derby winners. I can rattle them off the top of my head. And I can still see him there in every stride of the horse. I can still see him in my mind. But I always thought his best horse would either be Nijinsky or Survivor. Survivor was a short turn of foot from a furlong and a half out to beat Connell and Sandy Barkley with Noel Murdis trained him. Very prestigious.
And how did they, because sometimes when you've got like an icon and you really like look up to and revere, right? When you actually meet him, was it everything you expected or was it disappointing? Or
my hero was exactly how I perceived him to be. Half a loner, very dedicated, talented to the hill, and you just try to aspire. Well, I'd like to know what the man forgot. You know,
yeah.
he was so way ahead of his time, and there was never going to be a jockey. You can forget Frank Editore, you can mention Gordon Richards, you can mention Bill Shoemaker in America. No one was as better than Lester.
The public loved him, didn't they? Lester.
Who graced a pair of silks like him.
Yeah.
Lester Piggott, for me, was not only my idol, but he was everyone's idol and aspiration for them in them days, in the 60s, 70s.
So also, Tony, you started your career as a cabbie, but very soon you started getting into TV and films, didn't you?
No, well, in
what was your first role?
I'll tell you what happened. I went to the FAA, Film Writers Association, in 1976 while I was on the Norwich, because before I was a bookies runner, running down Hackney with dog track, putting the bets on for the punters. So if the punters won, they'd give me some money.
Yeah.
And over the course of the day, if the bookmakers won, they give me a 10% of the winnings.
Oh.
So if they won £1,000, I'd get £100.
Lovely, good
which
money.
In end up, it's 76, money, yeah. It was a fortune for me. I was only a knowledge boy. And then what I did, I thought, what can I do? Then I read a book about James Dean. I thought, well, I could do that. You know, I kept reading, you know, I got a bit, you know, starry-eyed about this. I thought, you know, I've got enough fun, you know, I'm not silly, you're going forward. Bang. I shot down to FAA, White's Lane, Film Arts Association. I signed on. They give me a card, go down there to Central Casting, register at Central Casting that you're going to be an extra. I said, yeah, anything, I don't mind, you know. Shoot down there, filled it in, give them a phone number, and 2 days later, the phone rang. So my mum said, Tony, there's a guy up here saying casting, what's he on about? I said, I'll get it, mum, you know, pick the phone up. Tony, can you go to Battersea Park? They're filming the Sweeney. I said, oh yeah.
Sweeney.
Yeah, so I'll shoot down to Battersea Park, and there it was, the old Bill chasing us. We were sort of like involved with a diamond robbery, and we were sort of like, you know, running the key fit with the geezer who's done all the robbery. And they was chasing us in Battersea Park. And after that morning's work, I got £12 cash for being a film extra.
Lovely,
then I thought, well, I want more of this. So I thought myself, you know, I've done a lot of other things other than that. But then I thought myself, I've got to get involved here. So I've done a foundation course in an acting school. I've done all that. Plus, I've got a good memory of remembering speeches.
I've got a great memory.
I can remember speeches of John F. Kennedy. I can recite the whole lot of his inauguration speech. Bit of Henry V and Shakespeare, which I can remember. But I thought, well, I can do all this, you know, all you only need is a bit of fun, a bit of know-how. And after seeing these actors on these sets, you know, they were more nervous than me, you know, I thought, well, I'm not that nervous, I've got more fun than these, you know, I can do this. So, well, even me and you, I mean, you go forward 25 years, and how many films have I done with you? We've done two
films. We had the same agent.
Yeah. And we've sort of entwined accidentally. There was no say I follow Grant or you follow
that's
me.
Right.
Just mixed. Night bus we done, 90 minutes, when we went to the film premiere.
Yeah, the BFI.
Fantastic. Yeah. I mean, you know, I mean, we had a little flavour out of the other one.
Yeah, I mean, the lovely thing is, with the job, being a cab driver, that flexibility is great for auditions and having that couple of days off to film and then back in the saddle.
Yeah, but I don't
it's great.
Know. It's funny, I mean, in that film game, you meet people and you meet in different places, coincidentally, in another time. I mean, going back to Michael Apted, I mean, the coincidence I've had with Michael, who directed almost 7 Up, because he's a big Hollywood film director, you see, and he's done many, he's done about 35.
He worked with massive stars, didn't he?
Well, he's done 35 feature films, and with Gene Hackman, Dustin Hoffman, Sigourney Weaver. I can tell you a story about her. She just finished filming Gullis in the Mist with Michael Apted, and I'm driving along St. Martin's Theatre one day. A hand goes up and a woman comes in with a big scarf around her face, sunglasses, very Norma Desmond, you know, one of them, didn't want to be recognised. I'm going to take her to Claridge's. Well, I look between her, I thought, that's Sigourney Weaver. So I said, Sigourney, I said, you and I have got a lot in common.
What a taxi,
I swear, really? Absolutely. Yeah. She said, pardon? I said, Michael Apted directed you in Gorillas in the Mist. I said, and he directed me in 7 Up. Well, once I said that,
It was the barriers
came down. It was like Thursday afternoon. One did the shutters go down and the locks go on the door. It was the locks unlocked, the shutters went back up. She took me into Claridge's. We had a 10-minute chat and she was very gracefully, you know, very nice lady. And the same happened with Dustin Hoffman. My wife, when I was 40, 25 years ago, I'm walking along Madison Avenue in New York, and Dustin Hoffman's coming towards me. I said, Debbie, my wife, I said, get the camera out, Dustin Hoffman. And as he got right up to my arm, I went bang, I said, Mr. Hoffman, I said, it's a pleasure to meet you. I'm going to lunch now. I said, you was in with Michael Apted, he's a good friend of mine. Oh, he said, how's Michael? I said, he directed you in Agatha. We had a 3 or 4 minute chat. Shook his hand, I had a photo done in them days, it was a normal camera rather than a selfie, and he went off and
Amazing how the acting joins people.
You entwine,
yeah,
you know, exactly. It's funny, really. I mean, these are the type of things that do happen to me, and coincidentally.
So, we've had your past and about the acting, also the years you've been a cab driver, Tony. If we talk to the cab trade now, we talk about how we are now as a trade. How do you feel the cab trade is and the history? The last 10 years, Cameron, well, Tory government, well, Uber.
As you know, I remember being on the demonstration with me, you, George Galloway, and about 1,000 cab drivers outside Downing Street.
Remember that?
When it all went down, and the comment George Galloway made when he pointed to Downing Street with Cameron and Osborne at the helm was when he said, money is changing hands. Now, I didn't realise what gig economy was then, and I didn't understand what Uber represented. I didn't know all the backhanders. I didn't know the BlackRock, the existence of that, of £655,000 per year for Mr. Osborne's...
lovely part-time job if you can get it.
For one day per week. Now, you look between the lines there... You can only see one thing, and it starts with C and ends with N. But I won't say the word corruption because it could get me into trouble. I'm just allegedly saying it. But all them cab drivers, when we go on them demos, on Topical Road, Bank Junction, Downing Street, nearly every other week when we was all there by the cenotaph, walking out the cabs, having a chat and everything, you know, you say to yourself, what is it all about? We have over a 200 year history of cabs. We've got the best camaraderie in any job, the best trust we've got in every job, You know, we're the most professional job with wheelchair accessibility. And, you know, we are the backbone of London. And we have been spat out of Mr. Khan's agenda. And now we are now sort of on the back foot. I would stress to every cab driver who has got their badge and bill and are fighting for their livelihoods to maintain their stance on this mayor, because he cannot last forever. He should have been gone last year. As you know, if this corona wasn't here now, you would have had the vote in May last year.
He's got another year.
And he got another year by luck.
And I don't know, the fact that he got that other year, the fact that he's been allowed to make such big decisions like a 12-year age limit, the LTNs, surely he's only having this year by like default, and he shouldn't be allowed to make such massive decisions. Look, do you think it's about time that the government said, we don't need a mayor. We have a minister for London already, yeah? Because how much is that costing Londoners? The mayor, the city hall, all the staff. It's costing an absolute fortune.
That's all what you know. It's all what you don't know you should be worrying about. What happened to Crossrail? What happened to that? The rail, that, millions and millions. Still not maintained.
That's right.
Hammersmith Bridge is another sort of bunion on his foot. You know, let's not forget, you know what I see him do the other day? I see it in the local paper. He drives a 4x4 with security guards in probably an armoured car, something like the President's got. And while he pulls up at City Hall, he gets a little bike out the boot of the car, or another car comes along with a bike. He puts on a crash helmet, and he drives 100 yards from where the security let him off to City Hall just to get a camera.
It's pathetic. Shot.
It's pathetic. I mean, everyone can see through the transparency here.
I mean, as while we're talking now, the next mayoral election is in May, just over a month. Who do you think the cab trade could be looking to vote for? Bearing in mind, we've interviewed Sean Bailey. Again,
I think he's lightweight. He's for the other mob, which I don't want to have no dealings with. Yeah. It's the only four-letter word with a U in it that I don't like to repeat.
Yeah.
And you know what that is. But going back to that, probably David Curtin's just above the parapet of voting.
But when you look at it, I'm looking and it's got like David Curtin, Lawrence Fox, Farah London. Yeah. We've got all these independents and Brian Rose.
Yeah.
They're all these independents. And what was interesting about we talking about the other mob, I was watching a video last night someone sent me and said, look, have you seen this? And Brian Rose, who we've been trying to get on to interview.
I saw that interview. Gig economy, Amazon, Uber, you know, shooting himself in the foot.
All going to be donators.
Absolutely.
And he's talking to a cab driver about scrapping the congestion charge. Well, cab drivers don't pay congestion charge, right?
Yet,
right. But
they don't pay to go to the London airport at the moment. Heathrow. They're looking at £10 in minimum charge to go there.
But if someone's coming in like Uber and want to donate if you're mayor, they don't do that for nothing.
Well, of course everyone's got their backers and they're sort of greasing the palm of the hand somewhere along the line.
I think the trouble for the cab train, Tone, I don't know how you feel, but the trouble I feel is that we just seem to be looking for a viable opponent, and it don't seem to be anyone out there. I don't know.
I've looked at all the candidates with interest, and they're all, to me, they all seem lightweight. There's no one with any teeth. They're all politically correct. They're all sort of no one to pick the TFO up by the scruff of the neck. Let's not think about the Londoners. What's happening to London? London is a ghost town. The pubs, the theatres, the stations. All the businesses. I walked down the Strand the other day. The Strand is not only closed, but the offices and the shops down there, they're up for sale. So the rents and the rates have decimated the whole lot of the Strand, which is a vibrant London place. The Savoy, you know, everything, it's all closed.
You're from the East London, I'm from South London, but we're Londoners.
Absolutely.
Right? And we have this lovely affinity with our city where we're from.
I love London.
And when you look at London now, it's heartbreaking, Tony, isn't it?
I'll tell you what. It
needs someone a bit special, like you said. If the government ain't going to do it, you would look to the mayor to fight our corner. But we've got a mayor who's just saying, shut them roads, the mayor, more cycle lanes.
No.
London won't get back on its feet.
The mayor's too lightweight. The mayor's too politically correct. He's all right for a photo shoot, and he'll go there for that sort of thing. But when it comes to the nitty-gritty, he's not a boxer. When he goes in the ring with someone bigger than him, he cannot fight. And he hasn't got the teeth for London. The job is above him. And I would suggest to you, and anyone listening to this, please don't vote for this man. He's incompetent. He's too politically correct. And he's too, most of all, he hasn't got the ability to run London, despite whatever you see. And the tragic thing is, he's probably leading the polls, and that's what we've got to offer in the next 4 years.
Well,
not for me.
Normally, Tony, we would meet up in Sapori's and have this sort of conversation
over a
plate of spaghetti.
Yeah, absolutely.
Put the world to rights. We can't do that at the moment. We don't know when we're going to be able to do that. But what message have you got for your fellow cabbies who are watching this? If you were sitting in the cafe and they're all sitting there, what would you say to them, Tony?
I'd say be patient. Be proud that you're still a London cabbie. We're always one. We've still got the backbone. We've still got the confidence to go forward. And most of all, they won't kick our arse and we won't stay down. But the best thing about it, we are a good team, all of us, and we should march forward to the bitter end.
Thank you, Tony.
You're welcome.
Thanks for coming in.
You're welcome.
I hope you enjoyed that interview as much as I have. It was fascinating.
To all my fans out there, up the Spurs.
We're going to cut that. Where's the Chelsea scarf? Thank you. Wow, what a fantastic interview and what a character, Tony Walker.
Again, cab driver for decades, loves the trade, very passionate, and also a star in his own right with the award-winning TV series 7-Up. Well, I really hope you enjoyed that interview. And if you really liked it, please, on our YouTube channel, press the like button, and most importantly, subscribe. But it's not like your TV at home, it's free. Just press the subscribe button and we'll let you know when there's all new great videos for you to enjoy, watch and hopefully share. So like, subscribe and leave a comment. Thanks for watching.